Okay, so when you say I'm a theorist, that's what many people disagree with because they don't know what I do. Because I like to solve problems with computers. And I don't, and although I was for 18 years in an institute of theoretical physics, I wrote only two papers with the proofs in them and theorems. So my colleagues never knew how to really view me, and I think I'm just somebody who wants to, I'm the computational scientist who wants to solve problems with computers. Yeah. Well, from a computer scientist perspective, I'm not a theorist at all. From a quantum information theory perspective, as this is meeting about, I'm a practitioner and not a theorist. And what brought me to that was I like physics, computer science, chemistry, biology. So I like science. Again, I like the computing and being able to solve problems that are intractable is something great. So in the past, I used the Cray supercomputer with the new algorithms to solve problems in quantum magnets, bosons, so on, superfluid, supersolid, that were not tractable before. By mixing new hardware, new algorithms with new problems, one makes progress. But I got to the point where I was stuck because there are certain problems we cannot solve easily on classical hardware. But then I thought, more and more, if I had a quantum computer, I could solve it. So it got to the point where I said, I want to have a quantum computer. And in order to build one, one needs more money than I can get in a grant, and that's why I now work with Microsoft, because they do have much more money. And one needs engineers, one needs people to build hardware, one needs people to write code and program and so on, but I still want to solve problems with it. And I just use Microsoft as a way to get to the point where we do that. I help them, they help me. So it's just when you scale up your science and you go to big science, you need a sponsor who's capable of doing that. And so we have a nice symbiosis between science and business. Both sides must learn, must adapt and change. But it's been a great journey so far. One of the tipping points was when about 6 years ago, Michael Friedman asked me who could fund this super expensive project of really building a quantum computer. And I said, well, that's very easy. You go to the companies who can profit from the quantum algorithms developed by quantum information theory. Well, back then I was naive. Because the problem was, there's a big gap between theory, proving things, and really solving problems. So we heard things like, yes, with quantum computers we can solve global warming. With quantum computers we will cure cancer. With quantum computers we will have new batteries. We will design drugs, we will fold proteins, we will solve world hunger, we will eradicate diseases. That's what people who had the vision said. When you then heard the theorists chatting after the speech, they said, ha ha ha. So, but that's the problem. We have this quantum computer that people imagine as this ultra-powerful machine that can do anything. And on that, they project all the things they want to solve, but we don't have a solution yet. On the other hand, we have people who prove great theorems about the asymptotic scaling of certain algorithms, but we need to bridge that gap. And initially we thought it was easy, but it was much harder than we thought. Because, for example, global warming, how would you tackle global warming with a quantum computer? New batteries. One has to then think about what is a way that we could solve it with computers. Then we have to think what is the bottleneck there. Then we have to see if a quantum computer can, in principle, help us there. So the first step, I would say, is always, for any problem, the first step is we want to find a quantum algorithm for the problem with quantum speedup. Because if there's no quantum speedup on a quantum computer, then why would they use a quantum computer instead of a classical one? Now, this is the first problem, because for some algorithms, we don't know if there's quantum speedup. We can prove maybe that worst case there's not, but maybe in the typical case there is. But let's say we have one, and we say, okay, in principle, let's say we want to get better batteries. We say, okay, we know quantum algorithms in chemistry that have quantum speedup over the best known classical one. Then still the problem is whether one needs that, or whether there's some approximate classical method that's good enough. So this is a tough question to answer. But let's say we have one. For example, the database search and the no-growth algorithm has a quadratic speedup. Then the second step towards the application, I want to implement all my oracles. Implement the algorithm with all oracles. And check if there's still speed up. And that leads to long discussions with colleagues who are pure theorists, because we view the world differently. Let's talk about Grover search, which we all know. We only need square root of n curious to an oracle to find an element. While classically we need n, so there's a clear speedup. But now let's implement that oracle. Let's use the typical example. I give you a phone book and the phone number, and you should find the name. Then the way I view it is, when I do the lookup in the classical oracle, I look at one number and its constant cost. When I do the call to the oracle in the quantum setting, I need to each time load the full phone book. I need to load the full database. So for Grover search with a classical database, each call to the oracle need to load all n values. So the total cost is n to the 3/2. Classically, while I load it the first time, I find the solution. So the cost is n. So there's slowdown if I do it that way. So it's mostly a problem with I/O. And I'll show you more examples tomorrow, how things change suddenly when you consider I/O. Some theorists I talk to tell me that my worldview is not theirs, because I misunderstand what an oracle is. And that may be true. I just know what I can build. What I'm then told is how I should view it. For example, I have this tape on which I store my phone book. And then when I access it, I don't have to read everything sequentially, but I can't just put the position of the tape into a quantum superposition of all possible positions. Or I put the read head on my hard disk in a quantum superposition of all possible locations, and that way I read it in a single step. And so global search works on databases. Now, when I hear that, then my argument comes, well, but I can't build that. I don't have that. I don't have a hard disk where the read head can be in a quantum superposition of all possible locations. And even if somebody can build it, I don't know how to do the error correction for the position of the read head. So I have not seen a proposal how to build that in a scalable way. And so for now, when dealing with I/O, I'm saying we have to be very careful. If somebody finds a way of solving that problem, great. But I have not seen any theoretical proposal that can work yet. So we have to make sure that we don't read too much data. Then after that, I now have a proof that I have a quantum algorithm that is better than that scales better than the best known classical algorithm. And it's great. I have asymptotic speedup. But third, I want to check what is the actual runtime of my algorithm. What is the crossover scale? And I have to optimize the algorithm . My rule of thumb is to a circuit depth of less than about, let's say, 10 to the 14 gates. How to come to that number is basically, I don't want my calculation to take 100 million years. I want my calculation to finish in a matter of weeks or months. 1 month is about 10 to the 6 seconds. So with 10 to the 14 gates, if I want to finish it in a month, then I'm already assuming I can do a logical gate operation in 10 nanoseconds. I don't think we'll ever get there. It will be more microseconds or longer. But if the quantum algorithm is not at least faster, then there's no science fiction niche machine that I can imagine will do it. And in many cases, when one then sits down and works out the circuit depth for problem sizes that are still tractable classically, I'll show some examples that often one gets actually numbers like 10 to the 29 at circuit depth. And 10 to the 29 would mean about 10 to the 14 years of runtime. What that means is, yes, asymptotically there is exponential speedup potentially, but we cannot realize it in our lifetime. And most graduate students want to finish in about 5 years. Most postdocs need a new job within 2 years, so I think assuming a month of runtime is good. And this is the next challenge. But it means we need not only the asymptotic scaling, we really need all of the constants and the actual gate counts. And then, once that is done, once we have this theoretical thing done, then my fourth step is, let us actually map it to a real machine. It's an imagined machine that we can build. And we take into account the quantum error correction, layout, and more. Let's say I could build a machine with a million good physical qubits in a square lattice architecture, what would it actually take to map it to that, and can I do it? And then, that's the question. So what can we do? So what problems can we really solve? Now, when I ask that question, I get push back sometimes from students, or quite often. They say, we should build a quantum computer no matter what. We should not build it because there's a problem we can solve. We should build it simply because it's cool to build one. I totally agree. But it's hard for me to convince Microsoft to give us billions to do that. We may say, okay, let's do something like CERN, and we build one big quantum computer that the world shares. Then we can find $10 billion somewhere over decades. That's the slow path. The faster path is finding a way to make money with it. Ultimately, then somebody gives you more money up front. I also, when I ask people to help me find real applications of quantum computers, I'm also told that when people built the first classical computers, they didn't know what to do with them yet. And once we build a machine, somebody will find the use. That's kind of true. When people built the first classical computers, they did not think of Facebook or games. But they had in mind certain computational problems they wanted to solve fast, and they built the machines because they had problems they would solve faster with them. That's one. The other thing that makes it harder is, so it would be totally trivial for us now to build a quantum computer that is faster than a human can do certain things, if humans didn't have laptops. But we had decades of progress on classical computers. They have been doubling every year, that we have super fast classical computers now, and so the constants are so heavily tilted in favor of the classical computers, that most computational needs that we have, we can solve on our smartwatches, or cell phones, or maybe a PC sometimes. But usually tablets are enough. So where are the computational problems that we cannot solve and for which we would need a quantum computer? That makes it harder. That's why I want you to start thinking about problems we would solve with. And yes, then we walk through these steps here. And there are two approaches one can take. I'll walk through one today and through the other tomorrow. Let me first find some quantum algorithm. And ideally here say find some algorithm with proven quantum speed up. And then start from there. But then we now start discussing what problem can we solve. Global warming. Now we try to find a quantum algorithm for global warming. Or world hunger, we try to find a quantum algorithm for that. Or we take one like global search, and say now let's find an application for it somewhere. Let's look up a phone number in a phone book. Okay, well, that's not an application. So where is an application for Grover search? Well, where is an algorithm for factoring? Okay, we have that, and where can that be used? What one can also say is we can just start from a problem that is hard and that many people have, and where there's evidence that quantum mechanics might help. So instead of starting from a known quantum algorithm with known quantum speedup, we can start from a known hard problem where if quantum mechanics would help, it'd be great. It would really have big impact. And that's the topic of the quantum annealing that I want to start with today. Is there anybody here who has not heard of the D-Wave machine? Or quantum annealer? No, I think you've all heard about that. That was their approach. They wanted to build a quantum computer to solve real problems. They knew the qubits they had were not good enough to do any gate model operation, but one could build a quantum annealer. And they built a machine to solve optimization problems with quantum hardware, hoping to show that the quantum effects in the device give it an advantage over classical hardware. And if that works out, then that's a huge breakthrough. So that was their attempt. It's a high-risk gamble because there was no proof that it's better. But there was some data around that made everybody believe it's useful. And I want to show that here, and then explain a few things around it. Do you know what annealing is? Who does not know what annealing is? Annealing is a technology developed in the Bronze Age. You take metal and you hammer it into the shape of a vessel, and it gets brittle when you hammer metal. What they then found out, if they by chance placed it in the fire at night and it heated up and then cooled down slowly, many of the defects annealed out. When they heat it and cool it very, very slowly, you get close to the ground state. So you take a crystal with defects, you heat it up, you let it cool very, very slowly, and you can prove if you cool it exponentially slowly, it will find the ground state. If you cool it faster, it will still be much better than before. So that was turned in the 80s into an optimization algorithm called simulated annealing. What people do there is they map a problem. How do I move here? So let's start first with simulated classical annealing. You take a classical model, so you have some problem to solve. For example, you want to find the ground state of some classical problem, of some classical Hamiltonian. HP, your problem, and you want to find this ground state. How do you do it? You get a system described by HP, you heat it up, and you cool it down slowly. So simulated annealing performs a Monte Carlo simulation which samples state simulation of HP, and it slowly reduces the temperature. Then if you do that slow enough, then you end up in the ground state. The scale for slowness is set by the mixing time of the Markov chain that describes the Monte Carlo process. So how fast you can move between states. Indirectly. You can expect the scale. So if you look at the random walks, so this Monte Carlo processes are random walks through configuration, and now you have a certain algorithm that lets you decide which steps to take, whether you go left, right, up and down, and so on. And those choices will of course depend on HP. But when you look at the stochastic matrix that describes the random walk, then the gap of that matrix, so the gap between the largest and the second largest test of the eigenvalue gives you the time scale. It's a combination of temperature and that, so, but then as you go to low temperatures, you look at the possibilities for your walk, and it's basically, yeah, it's the time needed to get to the ground state in your walk. It depends on HP, but it's not a very simple function of it. Yeah. I will come to that. So this is, so this is, you do a walk in the canal and you sample. One relationship to quantum is, instead, is you can view that you do not do a random walk, but you could look at the probability distribution of your walk and do that like a wave function. And then as you cool down, you hope that your probability distribution functions will go towards the ground state. So there's that. And then you can do quantum annealing. And what we do there is we modify the problem. Namely, we say here, we cool it down. We start from high temperatures. And we cool down slowly towards the ground state. Instead of that, we could start in the ground state, but start from a simple problem and adiabatically go from that problem to the one you want to solve. So with quantum annealing, we do something that maybe I have a one parameter the Hamiltonians, and at time zero, so I have 1 minus s times some driver Hamiltonian, which is a simple one of which I know the ground state, and then I add in plus s times my problem Hamiltonian HP. Now I start initially, so I start when s equals 0 in the ground state. Of the driver Hamiltonian HD. And then I evolve adiabatically. And I end when s equal 1 in the ground state of my problem Hamiltonian. Yeah. I only care about finite size problems. It's always possible, but what you refer to is if they're not in the same phase, if that's what could happen is that as I evolve, that the gap between the ground state and the first excited state becomes very small. Yes, and in the hard problem, it becomes exponentially small. So now the question is, what is better? So this, if this is in the same phase and there's always a big gap and it's totally easy and then boom, we find it. But typically that will not be the case for a hard problem. And then the question is, how small does the gap become? How does the gap, the minimum gap during the evolution scale with my problem size? In simple problems it's constant or power law. In hard problem, it becomes exponentially small. Same here, how slow do I have to cool? It's the gap of this transition matrix, which also becomes exponentially small. Now it's the question of what is better. And a typical problem that one studies here is an Ising spin glass. Let me check. Is anybody here who does not know the Ising model? This is a really physics-y audience then. Yeah. Have you all heard about spin glasses? Or who has not heard about a spin glass? Okay, so we just take an Ising model where H is the sum over all I less than J, let's say. I have some coupling J, IJ, and I have a variable SI and a variable SJ. Just a simple Ising model where the SIs are in plus one or minus one. And now I choose random couplings here. If I choose all to be negative, the ground state is all spins up the ferromagnet. If I choose them randomly, it's a spin glass. It's a glass because once I cool that down, it starts moving very, very slowly. This is chaotic. What one can show is that finding the ground state of such an Ising spin glass is that NP hard. So you can map any problem in the complexity class NP to an Ising spin glass problem. I'm choosing the coefficients randomly. Yes. When you choose the I think it's sufficient to choose the JIJ to be either 0 or plus minus 1, and it's already NP hard. As long as it's not a planar graph that they form. So when you have two layers, or when you have one layer plus a field on top of it, then it's NP hard. So this is extremely hard because there are exponentially many local minima. When you sketch the energy landscape of such a spin glass, it basically looks like this. Very, very rough in high dimensions, with lots of funnels going down, and it becomes extremely hard to find the true minimum. As a function of the system size, there are exponentially many local minima, and you have to explore them all to find it. Or you go into it with a quantum annealer. From the quantum annealer, I write my problem Hamiltonian using qubits, some I less than j, have my coupling j, ij, sigma I times sigma j. And for my driver Hamiltonian, I just take a tensor field minus sum over I, sigma I. So I start with all my quantum spins pointing in the x direction, then I slowly ramp down that, I slowly ramp up this term, and I adiabatically remain in the ground state until I reach the ground state of the spin glass. But as I go there, I go through a phase transition from the paramagnet into the spin glass phase. And in that phase transition, the gap becomes very small. So basically what I have to do is, if I'm stuck in such a local minimum, I have to tunnel out of that into the next one. If I do it classically, I'm stuck in here, I have to climb over the barrier and go there. So these problems are very hard, and all the problems that you heard about that are in the NP, like traveling salesman problem or factoring, or they can all be rewritten as an Ising spin glass model. Yeah, so excellent question. What is better, fast quenching or slow annealing? And what we found is that you can prove when you go exponentially slowly, you can find it. With fast quenches, you can prove when you at least try all possible values, you can find it. The optimum is somewhere in between for most cases. When you go fast, you're always stuck in one of the local minima. If you can at least escape it a little bit by going not infinitely fast, then you have a chance to maybe not always fall into this one here, but sometimes also the come here. So empirically, a compromise is between the two. You do not go as slow as you should go theoretically, but you don't just quench. Now, so we know this is NP hard, but besides that, we don't know anything about which method is best. Should you just quench? Should you do it slowly? Could you maybe be reheat some parts, and quench them again? When we made big progress, for example, by saying, okay, what if you had just a small machine that can do small pieces? Let me just take always with 100 pins at random and quench them. We found that even a factor of 10,000 more better than the best method known since then. So there's big progress here possible, but you have to find out what method works. It's empirical. You can prove when you go very slowly that there is a gap of a matrix here that tells you your house low, but that's just an upper bound. Now, what is the difference between the classical annealer and the quantum annealer? Is there a question? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. That depends on your problem. If I look at a singlet magnet in the material, then this mostly can some 3D lattice and decays typically with 1/r³ or faster. When it's longer, there is a phase transition to a glass. Yes. There is a phase transition in the dynamics. You get so the petite minima becomes so deep that you freeze out. There's a certain temperature at which the time needed to explore the whole space diverges. It freezes, it jams and freezes. There's no broken symmetry. But it's just stuck somewhere, and one state, and that one here, could differ in millions of spins, but still the energy is very close. So with a classical anneal, I just want to cool down and hope when I'm stuck somewhere, I escape by thermal excitations. So let's say I'm stuck in a local minimum here. To escape there, classically I have to climb over the barrier. That's what simulated annealing does. With quantum annealing, I can quantum tunnel through the barrier. So if the barrier is tall and narrow, then it's of course much better to tunnel out, while when it's very broad and flat, then it's much easier to climb over. So the question now is, for a typical problem, is it better to climb over the barriers or to tunnel through the barriers? is it better to do quantum annealing or better to do simulated annealing to climb over it? And here's one of the first papers on that by the Trieste group, and they compared for a 2D square lattice spin glass like that with random couplings. As they cool slower and slower and slower, or as they anneal slower, what is the residual energy they reach? So what is the energy difference between the true ground state and the lowest state they reach? And it's extremely slow. They need to do at least 10 to the 6 steps to get to within about 1 in 1,000 of the ground state energy. But what they see is that the quantum annealer drops in energy faster than the classical annealer. So quantum mechanics helps here. And based on that, we were hopeful that quantum annealing is actually a useful technique. And so D-Wave built a machine. So they built a machine basically that implements an Ising spin glass with a transverse field term, and where they can change the ratio of the coupling so they can do the quantum annealing with a few limitations. This was a 2D lattice of size 6,400 spins. For 2D spin glass without magnetic fields, there is a polynomial time algorithm to find the ground state. That case with NQ. So they took, so they chose a problem for which one can get the ground state, but the method is much more flexible. Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, so when D-Wave built that, they have a few limitations. The first is the temperature is 15 millikelvin. They are not in the ground state. And once the gap becomes smaller than that, as it often does, then it's basically a mixed thermal quantum machine. So it's mixed thermal and quantum. So it's not an adiabatic quantum computer that stays in the ground state, but it mixes in thermal fluctuations quite a bit. The second is they have a 2D hardware graph. It's not quite planar, but it's a fixed graph they can do. So they cannot do all couplings. With C less than equal 6 neighbors per spin. The third problem one has is there's always calibration error. Of about 3% on the coupling. So, and then they just sold the machine. And people could buy it for $10 million and test it. And there was a big discussion around it. Does it work? Is it quantum or not? And we then looked at it, and what it seemed like, in the end, that's a one-hour talk by itself, is that the machine works as much as we can expect a quantum annealer to work, but it could also be easily described by a classical mean field type model. So it's kind of a sort of quantum mechanical. It is a quantum annealer, but Cram Smith and others found mean field models that mimic it very closely. Yeah. I'm coming to that. So we could not see any speed up. We found it does kind of what we want a quantum annealer to do, but it's not better than a classical code. Now we had discussions, is it a quantum device or not? And that comes back to the question of the semantics of quantum. For somebody from physics, if somebody really uses quantum spins, quantum spin half, then it's a quantum model. And even if there's a mean field description, it's still a quantum model or quantum magnet. If you look at it, on the other hand, from a computational point of view, then if the device has a good classical description, then it is not more powerful than a classical device. So let me show you what we found in data when we looked at it. I can show you first what D-Wave claimed. D-Wave showed the following plot. This is the time to solution to solve a problem on their 500. So this is the projected time to find a solution on the 512 spin problem. And it's essentially constant. This is the time to solution with the best classical algorithm they have, and once we reach 512 variables, it is 320,000 years on their best classical algorithm versus 120 milliseconds on their device. The time scales exponentially on the classical one, and on the quantum annealer, look at it. Pretty nice, right? What does it look like? Almost constant. So that's what they use to sell it. What they don't tell you is that this is almost constant because they have a constant overhead to initialize the machine. So this curve here is a constant plus an exponential. But when the constant is much bigger than the prefactor of the exponential, then it just looks constant. Once you subtract the constant, it starts looking different. So let me just show you one slide here. So this is what we first measured, went up to 512. If you look at the typical, so at the median time to solution, then yes, initially it's pretty constant. It starts to bend up a little bit. What you also see is if you look at the higher percentiles, the harder problems, it bends up more and more and it starts looking exponential. And if we write the good classical code, then it doesn't take 320,000 years, it just takes a second, or no, it just takes typically about 2 milliseconds to solve the same, but it also bends up. But when you now subtract that constant, then it looks quite different. It all looks basically, it grows exponentially with system size, and the slope seems to be about the same. So when you then try to look at the ratio of the two, to look at the speed up, so here I'm plotting the time to solution on a classical annealer divided by the time to solution on D-Wave divided by a factor n. Where does that factor come from? This is the fact that the D-Wave device is an analog device. It has these 512 spins that all act in parallel. And when I go from 512 to 1,000, 2,000, 4,000 spins, I add more hardware to it, and it all acts in parallel. I compare here to one core on my laptop, so to a fixed size machine. The fair comparison would be, as I grow my problem, I also put in more hardware into my laptop. So I divide the time on a single machine by the problem size. to have the scaling. And then we see that in the typical case, the scaling becomes about flat, same scaling. And when I go to the harder problem, this goes down. That's what my postdoc termed quantum slowdown. The time to solution on the classical compared to the quantum machine shrinks as you go to bigger problems. Now, that is not what we saw before in the Santoro paper. Santoro showed that there is an advantage. You find the ground state better, or you go there faster on with the quantum annealer than with the classical one. And here on D-Wave we didn't find that. So then one reason could be the finite temperature. If they could go to lower temperatures, it might help. One is that maybe it was not the same graph. This was not the square lattice. This was a different model. And there's also the problem of calibration errors. Calibration errors mean that these coupling constants here, the JIJs, are about 3% off. Now we have a problem with 500 spins, each coupled to about 6 neighbors, so we have about 2,500 couplings. If I now just see what is the typical error I get on the total energy, it is 3% times the square root of the number of couplers. Number of couplers is about 2,500, the square root is about 50, so I now have 3% times 50, I have a 150% error. That means to minimize the differ by 1 or 2 could switch. And it might be that the machine actually finds the ground state much better, but it's the ground state of a different model. And when it gets harder and harder, just it might find it faster, but it finds, but it just does not solve the same model. So it could be that. The other difference was in these tests, because of that limitation, we took the couplings to be +1 or -1, just this bit, so that there is a gap of 2 at least, that we have a big gap. In Santoro's paper, the couplings were continuous, real numbers. So we needed to look into that difference to find out what goes on. But what we've seen here is no advantage in scaling. And since then, nobody has seen one either. So I then asked a student to look into that. And there was one student who came to me as a first year bachelor student. He said he wants to do a quantum computing project. And typically when a student would come with that question, then I said, okay, wait until you had the first lectures in quantum mechanics. But we have so few girls at ETH that I said I can't send her away. And then I asked her, well, it's actually not too hard. All you need to learn is linear algebra, and you know that, right? So then I did ask her, why don't you read the first 3 chapters of Nielsen and the trunk? And she replied, yeah, she knows the book because she read it over Christmas and it was an easy read. So then I said, yes, that's the problem for her to solve. Can she find out why we don't see the speed up we expect on D-Wave? And then in about half a year, she found out, and they wrote the paper, and the poster said, let's send it to Science. They said, no chance. They sent it there, it got accepted. So she has her bachelor thesis published in Science. Since then, she finds it very hard to keep up with that. So now she moved to quantum software, Microsoft, she writes compilers while doing research on the site. But what did she find? It's basically, I have to tell you what Santoro did when he compared. Because how can you compare plastic annealing to quantum annealing on 6,400 spins? We cannot simulate it exactly. So what they actually mean by quantum annealing there was a classical algorithm inspired by quantum annealing. What they did was a patented Monte Carlo simulation. Since so many here are physicists, do you all know patented or not? Is anybody here not familiar with the patented? We have here, yes, if one dares to say yes, then I know it's half. Or a quarter maybe. Yeah. So when we do classical Monte Carlo, we sample states randomly. We take our lattice of spins, up and down spins on my lattice. I pick one of them. I propose to flip it. And then flip this and that and that. Then take a spin and I want to flip and I want to sample states with the probability that is P proportional to exponential of minus the inverse temperature times the energy of the configuration, just the Boltzmann weight. If the energy goes down, I flip it. If it goes up, I may flip it or not depending on the temperature. This is classically. So when I want to calculate the classical property, for example, just the quantity A, then I can write that as 1 divided by the partition function times the sum over all the configuration, the quantity A in the state C times the exponential of minus beta times the energy. What I do now in sampling is I just choose, I don't make take the all configurations. I pick some randomly in a random walk and I calculate the and I pick them proportional to their Boltzmann weight. Then I just sample the quantity A that I want to measure. This is beautiful and works classically. Now let's do it quantumly. It's the same. A is 1 over C times the trace of A times exponential of minus beta H. Now I'm stuck. Now I can't do that. If H is diagonal, then it's easy. Then I just sample the eigenstates. If H is not diagonal, then I first have to make it diagonal. Or I have to calculate this, which is hard. But now I can use a path integral. What that is, okay, so I want to use the path integral to rewrite that as a sum over some configuration C of AC times some weight in C. That I do with the path integral. What I do there is I just rewrite this here as the trace of A times and now the exponential of minus beta H. Let's split it into many tiny, tiny time steps. So this I'm rewriting as exponential of minus some beta divided by m to the power m. Many small time steps. What I do then is here I start, let me now draw it just in 1D. I draw my spins here. It can be up, down, up, down, up, down. at an initial time, and then between each of those exponentials, I insert the sum over all my basis states. So now I rewrite this as a sum, as a trace. So the trace, I write the sum over my basis states, let's call them S here, and I do S, A, and then this. Now I do the first step, exponential of minus beta divided by M, H, and now I'm going to insert another set. Let me call that S zero. Make the sum here over my S and my S zero and my S one. Then I insert an S one, S one. Then I go on, I get my next exponential of minus beta divided by M times H, and I insert another sum over a complete set of states, S two, S two, and so on, until at the end, after M steps, I get exponential of minus beta divided by M times H, and I close with S zero. I can draw that as I start from my state S zero here, and now this is just a sum over classical states again. That's a sum over the negative basis states, and each one of them, if these are quantum spins, just look like classical Ising spins, up or down. So I take the sum of all states at zero, and then I propagate a small time beta divided by m to my next set of states S1, and so on up. So at the end, I have my last slice Sm, and then it goes back to the first one when I close the trace. And when m is large enough, then this I can easily calculate by the tail expansion, for example. So what I then get is if I take this at the finite m, then I get the tail expand this, then I get then approximation. So it's then this sum here, which is then sum over where these classical states here, the spin state at all of these time steps, with some weight, is given by these matrix elements. So I then get this to be a sum over all these states from S0 to Sn minus 1 of the quantity A in the state S0 times the weight that depends on all these from S0 to Sn minus 1. This is just a classical sum from which I can sample. So the idea of the path integral is whenever you have a, let me draw that here now again, is whenever you have a quantum system, then you can map it to a classical system with one more dimension. So this was your space dimension. You add one more dimension here, which is the imaginary time dimension. It's called imaginary time because I'm basically expressing exponential of minus beta h, which is I times the time. It goes from zero to beta, and I split that into m small time steps. And I replicate basis states at every time step, and then I get a classical system in the more dimensions. The quantum spin model in 2D becomes a classical spin model in 3D, a system of bosons, which is here becomes just spaghetti, a system of fermions is challenging, because what if I have fermions and now I take this fermion, that fermion, and I change to fermions as I evolve. Then when I get to the last time slice, I'm back in the first state, except I've now exchanged two fermions. What happens when I exchange two fermions? The sign of the wave function changes. So when I close the trace, I get a minus sign, and these weights here become negative. That's the so-called sign problem of fermions. So we cannot use that for the fermions, but we can use it for quantum spins. We can use it for bosons. And what Santoro did for a quantum annealing, he never imagined somebody would build a quantum annealer like D-Wave. But he knew path integral Monte Carlo. So he said, let us just take this idea of quantum annealing, but let's not do it in real time, but let's just do a Monte Carlo simulation of this path integral. And as we randomly flip our spins, we slowly change our parameter. So this is what we call a simulated quantum annealer, or a path integral Monte Carlo quantum annealer. I do the same idea of slowly changing the coupling, so slowly ramping down the field, or slowly ramping up the coupling strength of the Ising term. And I just do it in a Monte Carlo simulation. And that's what that's when he found that. Yeah. No, it's not. It's the same Hamiltonian. It's the same protocol for changing S. It's the same protocol. I start at zero. I evolve. And the end when S is 1 for this model. But the dynamics is different. In the quantum annealer, it is, in the adiabatic quantum computer, it's Schrödinger's evolution. In D-Wave, it is some kind of open your systems evolution, some noise coupled to it. In Santoro's paper, it is a stochastic evolution of the configurations in the path integral. He simulates the system at a certain temperature. And if he were to do that long enough, that gives the same equilibrium property. This gives the same expectation values, but it's a different dynamic for the same model. He does it with this classical Monte Carlo dynamics, with the random walk instead of the Schrödinger evolution. And with that, he found a difference. Now, what did my student Bettina Heim find? What she found, looking at that, she found she can actually reproduce it. There's actually a time step dependence here. So she looked at, could it be the different model? Could it be the different lattice? In the end, she boiled it down to it's a question of the time step dependence in this path integral here. When you go to too few time steps, the energy never drops down. It's bad. When you go to infinitely many time steps, it drops pretty quickly, but then it gets stuck somewhere, it saturates, it does not improve anymore. But what she also found is that when she now plays with it, then if she chooses something in between, and here she found something, the optimum is around 32 time steps for beta of 20. So when the time step is about of order unity, that seems to be optimal, then she reaches lower and lower temperatures. So if you want to now run that as just a classical optimizer, then you would just optimize your time step because you don't care about the physics. The right physics is obtained when these time steps are infinitesimally small, so when m becomes infinite. This is clearly not the best way of getting the ground state. So if you now always at each time you run, so choose the best time step for that, then this is the classical annealer, and this is the simulated quantum annealer with the right time step chosen. But when you want to look at the physical limit of an infinitesimally small time step, this is the classical annealer, this is the quantum annealer. It goes slower. And you can very easily explain why that's the case. Yeah? So this is finite but low temperature. In classical annealing, you reduce the temperature. So this curve here is you just reduce the temperature. This is the quantum annealer. You start at the very low temperature, much smaller than the gap of either HD or HP. And then I stay at the temperature. I start with a strong transverse field, the strong X term, with all spins pointing in X. Then I slowly anneal this down and this up. So here I reduce my quantum fluctuations. In the classic annealer, I lower the temperature, which reduces the fluctuations. Here I reduce the strength of the transverse field, which makes the spins precess. Now, how can it be better in the non-physical limit of large time steps? How easy do you think is it for me to tunnel through that wall here? But let's now make the simulation with a time step of a minute. I'm asking you all to close your eyes for a minute. And then I walk out the door. So when I have this and I want to escape from here to here, let me now draw that with the path integral. So I have my, and I want to go from here to here. If I go continuously, then I have to go through the barrier, right? There's no way. I have to, at some point, be in the barrier. If I do it with discrete time steps, large ones, then I can just jump through it in one step. And because of the time step error, you've never seen that I had to be in the barrier. And so effectively, I can be faster. So that was what she found there, that, yeah, and when we then later showed that to Santoro, then he said, of course, you optimize the time step to get the best possible results, which is totally legitimate as long as you think this is a classical algorithm inspired by quantum. So here we see that this advantage in that model was because in the classical algorithm, you don't have to obey the laws of physics. You can cheat. I can just ask you to close your eyes and I tunnel through the wall. So, but the question was there, this is not the same thing, right? This is not the same dynamics. The quantum annealer does quantum mechanics, this does the random walk in the space of path integrals. And we know that the dynamics makes a difference. And it has been argued that what we learn from the path integral Monte Carlo cannot be used to tell us anything about quantum annealers. Because we know if you have a critical point, the dynamical critical exponent in nature and in that simulation is different. So as I go now here, I show the face the diagram of the quantum spin glass as a function of the field. As when the field is strong, then all spins point in the x direction, and I slowly reduce that to zero. What happens is I first go through a phase transition into the spin glass phase. At that phase transition, the gap closes with the Powell law of the system size. That Powell law is different for unitary dynamics and Monte Carlo. Typically, the Powell law is smaller in Monte Carlo, but it's different. It's not the same. But then this is not the small gap. The small gap happens when I go into the spin glass phase. Then as I change the field, what is the ground state changes? There can be huge changes in the ground state as I reduce the field. There are many barriers that I have to go through where the gaps become exponentially small. So we next looked at cases, kind of what can we say about the tunneling linking up the two barriers, but the gap becomes exponentially small in the problem time. The first gap is where you enter the spin glass phase. That is not the minimum gap. So that gap syncs with the power of the system size. The other gap syncs at least exponentially. This is an effect of avoided crossings, and you may have two low-lying states that have almost the same energy, but their dependence on the transverse field gamma is slightly different, so they cross at some point. And these states are typically different by flipping half the spins or so. Now I have to go from this state to that state to an avoided crossing. We have to flip basically all spins at a time when the transverse field is small. So then by a simple argument, you see that the gap is exponentially small, because when you want to flip, let's say, this case spin, you have to go to the case order perturbation. What happens then in addition is that the field where it happens also shrinks, so it's worse than. So these are the typical cases, and we looked at the simplest case where that happens. And the simplest case would just be a ferromagnet. And let me say I slowly change my field. I want to go from all spins up to all spins down. So I have to flip all the spins. This is the simplest case where that happens. So I want to see what is the time I need to tunnel from all spins up to all spins down in an Ising ferromagnet with a very weak transverse field. And we know as a function of the splitting, the time I need to go from here to here adiabatically is 1 over the gap squared. When I do that in the path integral, it typically looks like this. I have all spins up, then at some point it might jump down, and then again at some point it comes up. So when I plot that just as the function here of the magnetization, then it's mostly up, then it comes down, then it comes up again. And what one can prove is that the probability of such an instant on occurring is proportional to the gap. So the probability for this to occur is proportional to the gap squared. So let's say we start with all straight, then this occurs with the probability of the gap squared. Once that is done, then I can just move that up, and now all spins are pointing down. The rate limiting factor is getting this first kink and anti-kink in. And that case with, and that probability is the case with the gap squared, so the time until I have this case with one over the gap squared. That's the argument. And when you then check that with numeric, here we have for three different problems with three different negative fields. The solid surface is the unitary evolution. The open surface is the path integral Monte Carlo. The scaling is identical. So when you go from one minimum to another one through a single barrier, then we can prove that when the gap is when the gap is small, the rate limiting factor for unitary evolution and Monte Carlo is the same. So with that, we can understand why there's no quantum speed up, because the scaling is the same for those barriers. Now, the quantum Monte Carlo, as I told you, can even be accelerated by taking large time steps. It made the code faster, and they can cheat. But they can do even better, because I start here with all spins up, and I have my path wiggling here. Spins fluctuate a little bit. Then I get to the case where I have the instanton and the instanton. And the reason why I need both is that because of the trace here, the initial state has to be the same as the final state. So I start from here, I have to go back to here, and so that's why I have to go through it and back. That's where the scaling is with 1 over gap squared. But now, why do I need to close that in my simulation? I don't care about simulating this D-Wave device, I just care about finding the ground state of a spin glass. So what I can do now is, instead of taking the trace, I can just do arbitrary open gap to the boundary conditions. I can just cut open the path integral. It does not have to close. Just make an open path in time instead of the periodic. And now I start with all straight, and then I have to, then when I go through, I only need a single instanton in here. I don't need to come back. What does that mean? It means the scaling is not 1 over gap squared, the scaling is 1 over gap. I have a quadratic speed up. And in simulations, we can prove that quadratic speed up. So here, these are just quantum spins in a transverse field. These are not fermions. So I'm dealing with quantum spins here, not with fermions. Just dealing with quantum spin 1/2 in a tensor speed. You could map it to fermions, so why would you do that? When you talk about Jordan-Wigner, then you're talking about mapping fermions to qubits or quantum spins. So I don't need that yet. So here I just close the trace normally and it works. But what I'm saying now is, in my classical optimizer, I don't have to close the trace. I can cheat. I can cut it open. Now I'm no longer sampling the real physical system. And D-Wave has a paper showing that this does not sample the real physical system. But I don't care, because it gives me a quadratic speed up. As an optimizer. Okay. So we find that the scaling comes down quadratically. So what we've learned is that D-Wave has actually built a quantum annealer that works as well as we expect the quantum annealer to work. We've understood a lot more about what quantum annealers can do. We checked empirically that the D-Wave device does not have a scaling advantage over the classical code. We did not understand it at first, we understand it now. And by looking at that for 3 years, and essentially by taking them seriously, we found new classical algorithms that have a quadratic speedup over a quantum annealer. We call that a quantum-inspired annealer. So this has led us to new classical algorithms, which we call quantum-inspired algorithms, that outperform the best classical state-of-the-art by factors of 1,000 or 10,000. After that, what happened is that some of my colleagues said, okay, let's use that for real problems. So Stephen Jordan just took his quantum gamma tech. Carlo's code for D-Wave and applied it to the viability problems. And there's a big contest every year about who has the best solver for set problems. And he found that his simple code of 100 lines was beating the state-of-the-art classical set solver that has been refined over decades. Then he submitted that in the next year's round, and he expected to win. He did not win because another Dagger colleague of mine, Helmut Katzgraber, wrote an even better quantum-inspired code. But now these solvers are basically the state-of-the-art solvers for set problems. The spin glass problems. And it comes just by seriously looking at how would they use a quantum computer to solve this problem. So it led to great progress. And now both of them work in my group at Microsoft, and we'll have that up soon as the service that you can use and play with, we hope. So that's, let me go back to the list I started. Is the first step is finding a quantum algorithm with quantum speedup. If you don't have quantum speedup, it's still worthwhile, but it may give you a great new classical algorithm with quantum speedup, with quantum-inspired speedup. So that's what we learned here. Quantum annealing is extremely useful on classical hardware. That has two advantages. First of all, quantum information science has helped solve real problems faster. And secondly, we can do it on today's classical hardware. We can do it now on big problems. Now, will a quantum annealer ever be useful given that? It's a yes. There's one short-term hope. The short-term hope is quantum Monte Carlo. Here, this only works if all of these weights remain positive. When we have fermions, that's not the case anymore. When we just have transverse field, that's the case. If we take a driver, that's more complicated, XX terms, XC terms, and more, then I can create models where some weights become negative. In that case, I'm basically having frustration added to my path. I have destructive interference added to the path. But I cannot capture, there's no quantum Monte Carlo equivalent of that. So having terms here that cause a sign problem means I don't have the matching algorithm. It doesn't exist. Meaning I don't have a proof that it doesn't work. So I don't have a proof that I have a classing algorithm that has speed above. But I don't have a proof either that it will help having random signs added in. May or may not. In the first test we did in the simulations, it at least didn't hurt some of the time. But there's the hope that a so-called non-stochastic quantum annealer may be better. There's no proof that it can be better, but maybe. The other is this path integral Monte Carlo algorithm has a quadratic speed up over a quantum annealer like D-Wave. But there are quantum algorithms that can accelerate classic random walks by implementing them as quantum walks. So when you take the Monte Carlo simulation and you implement it as a quantum walk, then you get the quadratic speedup over the classical code. If you combine that with making the boundaries open, you get a quartic speedup. So with the gate model quantum annealer accelerating the Monte Carlo simulations with quantum walks, you get nice speedup. But it needs a pretty big machine. So tomorrow we look at problems where we can answer yes to the first, and then we'll go to real quantum problems and not just a quantum inspired solution. Thank you. In the real quantum, yeah, so, yes, so I, for any problem, I can give you a driver that solves the problem in constant time. It's easy. I have a certain solution like up, up, down, down. Then just have a driver that first rotates the spins to be up, up, down, down, and then it turns on your problem, Hamiltonian, and you're in the ground state. So for every problem, there is a schedule that gives it to you in constant time. The problem is just you want a schedule that works for all problems. And that we don't know. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. Look, yes. Yes. This is an extremely good question. We're looking at kind of what indicators could be proxies that would tell you how it looks like and what method would be the best. The naive approach is you just try both and you know. Yeah, that costs the factor two. That's the waste, yes. So you want to find out what you should use, and there are ideas how that could be found out. Yeah, more questions? Okay, good. Yeah.